Welcome to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies poised to transform our lives for better or worse are the focus of this podcast. Almost here means these technologies are now here and starting to be used. We're just around the corner, from Bitcoin to artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Future Tech Podcast. I'm your host, Juliette Lamar, and we have joining us today, Anton Mozgovoy. He is the CTO at Humaniq. Welcome, Anton.
Hi there, everyone.
So, Anton, Humaniq is a really interesting company. Why don't you give our audience a little overview about what it is you do?
So it's very interesting the way you pronounce Humaniq, Humaniq. Everything is good. It's actually very interesting because our targeted market is Africa. So let me tell you a bit about, well, again, like Humaniq, Humaniq, Humaniq. Why is it everything that we do? It all falls under all of this, you know, like the same name, though it could be, spelled in three different ways. So we provide social and financial services for the unbanked. So that is why we currently operate in 10 African countries. When I say social and financial services, why those, you know, two things go together? Because they're based on three main pillars what we do. So number one, we create digital identities for those who don't have government IDs. Number two is that we provide crypto wallets using our hybrid blockchain as an alternative to the banking system. And then number three is that we provide secure and free communication services for those who lack it. So would it be any peer-to-peer services? You can imagine marketplaces, chats, everything like that. And since Africa, besides, again, African dialects, is mostly English and French speaking, again, outside of Swahili or Afrikaans, it really depends on the language as how you pronounce it, whether it be Humaniq or Humaniq, right? Or would it be Humaniq as more, I would call people from US or Canada because I'm based in Canada. So that's how would I pronounce it?
Wow. I mean, such a huge undertaking. Just to give our audience an idea about how important this is, do you have any percentages or numbers that you can throw out to give us an idea of how big this issue is?
Yes. So just to give you a clear example of how big the issue is, in 2018, the term unbanked is still vague, so it's unregulated. So you and I can speak about different things as to what the unbanked means. So in simple words, the World Bank has estimated that there are more than 2 billion adults that either don't have access to the banking system for whatever hurdles they might have, or they just simply don't have any possibilities, or they just don't pass any criteria that the banks would have. So pretty much there are more than 2 billion people that don't have access to the banking system worldwide.
Wow. I mean, that is huge. And you also bring up the fact that you're helping people and communities get ID identification cards. That is also a very interesting segment for me is, you know, how do you give these people IDs? How do you check, you know, who they really are and get them the proper identification?
The identification problem has always been an issue ever since we remember ourselves. The way we try to tackle this problem is the technology standpoint. So what happens is that every user that joins our platform goes through the biometric identification system. So we take two images of the human being. So first of all is the image to identify whether it's a unique face, something that we have never seen before. And then number two is the second image where we actually verify whether it is a live human being, whether it is a photo of an actual human face, right, rather than a photo of a human face. And so pretty much ever since then, we're not actually storing your picture, right? We're not storing your face. We're rather storing the descriptor, which is pretty much, again, just like a hash sum of your digital identity. And that starts, and that's where your path of, you know, digitalizing your identity starts. Because ever since then, our partners, right, so any business that joins Humaniq platform, any startup or any service that we provide on the platform is able to safely and secure use that descriptor to actually identify you on the platform. So whether you're trying to make a payment, Again, you just simply can take a picture of your face, and that would pretty much, again, verify that you is you. So what Humaniq is doing is that we're not saying that, for example, the person that looks like Anton Mozgovoy is actually Anton Mozgovoy. What we're saying is that a unique biological human being, right, that looks like this person is that person. So we're not, that's just a very first step in actually making sure that people do get government, you know, realized identities. So number one is pretty much as our step is just creating that standard, creating that format that other companies can adopt and then start using. And that's a long route ahead, you know, just working with the governments, making sure that they do accept this form identification.
And providing people with identity and providing people with a place to control their own finances, you know, whether it be a crypto wallet or a bank of some kind, you know, you're essentially giving people freedom.
What I'd like to say about Humaniq is that it's a platform of opportunities. So we're not here as an NGO. We're not of, you know, what another charity fund. And then we're not just yet another, I would say, conventional business. What I would like to call it is a platform of opportunities. So we're here providing these three basic pillars, right? So identification, financing, right? So pretty much that sending, storing, accepting, et cetera, et cetera. And then number three, that's the most important part, is the communication piece, right? So that's how our interaction between humans, between services happens. And then on top of that, you add additional value services. So would it be online education? Would it be remote work? Would it be online aid, or, you know, micro aid? Or would it be, again, telemedicine? So anything on that level adds just additional values. So, you know, whoever joins Humaniq is just yet another platform. It's not yet another platform. It is a platform of opportunities. For those who seek the opportunity, we'll take it. For those who don't look for it, well, we won't be able to help them.
I love how you put that. It's a platform of opportunity, and that's truly what it is. Can you give us a few of your Humaniq use cases where you're seeing this in action?
Absolutely. So again, Humaniq, so first of all, I would like to mention our emission model. So since when Humaniq was just you know, at the inception level, we decided that, well, yet even though the mobile phones has become something personal, something on you know, so something that would belong strictly to you, and the price, they drop dramatically every single year, yet they're still too expensive for the majority of the population. So that is why we decided that we created this emission model, which states that every unique human being, and that's something that we guarantee with the identification piece, is entitled to receive the predefined set of HMQ tokens. So we would like to call it as an initial capital that you can use to actually buy the mobile phone through which you can get access to remote jobs or to online education. So we're working with different partners in different directions for our users to actually get access to remote jobs. So that's one use case. Another use case is actually very cheap and remote education. So we're working with different partners in Europe and US as to where, how you can get a very cheap online education, so online degree that would be accredited in the US. So that's, you know, that's a long way route in terms of how you can actually get making sure that people do get accepted, and then they do get, well, in terms of how they will get paid and then how they get subsidized, and then what's going to happen throughout the course.
Wow. That's pretty exciting. Tell us a little bit about the Humaniq expedition.
Yes. So, Humaniq Global, I would say the expedition was just like a final step, right, of the bigger challenge that we had, and we called it Humaniq Global Challenge. So that happened last year in 2017. So we've accumulated total number of startups participating of more than 450 startups. So that was the total number of participants. What happened is that they went through several steps of, you know, going through the review of their business model, of their technical progress, of their actual products that they want to achieve. And then the final outcome, the three winners, right, of the Humaniq Global Challenge, together with us, we went to Kenya on the expedition to make sure that the executives, right, so we're talking about CEOs, the CTOs of those startups, would actually meet their real clients, the real people, right? And then would have a chance to pretty much like in a form of a hackathon, create a product based on their product or on our product or, you know, a joint thing that would help solve the problem of their users. So that was more like an intention for the, you know, the businesses that would like to join our platform and then would like to work on and operate on our platform would have a real touch of the human beings that they try to help. So it's not the figures, it's not the metrics or the KPIs that they just try to, you know, overcome. It's the real people behind everything on that.
That's fantastic. Such a wonderful community that you are creating here.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Julie.
And so let's talk a little bit about, you know, your user base and how people are using that to grow different things.
Sure. So currently, again, as I would like to say, because now I'm checking in every single morning and the figure is growing. So we have more than 334,000 users. So we add like 5,000 to 6,000 users every single day now. So you would like to ask, well, what are all of those users doing? So there's several baseline products that we add and then we emphasize on users joining. So again, as I've mentioned, it all starts with the communication part and with the communication piece and the wallet piece out there. So from the wallet piece, that's where users can actually operate on the P2P exchange platform. So they can exchange Humaniq, you know, from the mobile money to pretty much any single object, whether it's service, object, goods, whatever. So that's the baseline product. Now, on top of that, we also add additional services. So we also launched Humaniq Stories recently, and that product allows users to actually share and you know, share the stories, the success stories, their own success stories, right? And then read about others and then actually, you know, vote for whatever stories, you know, is there and actually making sure that they're, you know, the winners or, you know, the winners to get prizes. We also plan on adding more services on that. So based on the fundraising, so that the users would be able to actually create their own fundraising pages, describing what and why do they need funding for, to make sure that the other users on the platform and outside of the platform would be also able to fund that beginning.
There's so many ways to be involved with Humaniq. You know, that you're mentioning so many of them. You also are open source, so people can contribute in that way as well. Is that correct?
Yes. So first of all, our client, right? And then pretty much our code base, it is open. It is open on the GitHub. More than that, we also have an open API. So there are more than 100 API endpoints that are available and pretty much everything that we half on our platform is, you know, is open, so anybody can actually, you know, join and work on the same platform, create their products or their apps on the platform, or simply select specific use cases, right, or simply select specific needs for your platform. So for example, for one of our platforms, for one of our business partners, they only needed the verification piece for their, again, online education courses, because they wanted to make sure that they do know what person is taking the exams. So to make sure that it is exactly the same person, you know, throughout the entire course. So they didn't need the wallet piece, right? They didn't need the communication piece, but what they needed is the identification piece. So they simply selected the endpoints for that, and that's how they interact with Humaniq. So what we're also saying is that, as I've mentioned in here, there's so many different aspects that we focus and that we work on, and the problems are big. And then what we're saying is that they're too big for a company, but they're never too big for, you know, a group, a consortium of companies. So that is why we're open to any communication, any cooperation. And if you see, if you do see any synergies, right, in issues, in problems that we're trying to solve or that we're working on, we're always open and then we're always there, you know, to help or to work together.
That's fantastic. So, and when it comes to, you know, boots on the ground, you have a very large ambassador program. So tell me a little bit about the ambassador program, the ambassadors themselves, and then the user experience for people who are experiencing Humaniq in their community.
Absolutely. So I'll start with why eventually we even started an ambassador program. Why do we need it? So the problem is that the users that we try to help, that we try to touch, they're not, you can't find them online. You can't simply run Facebook or, you know, Google Ads campaign, and then, you know, that's how would you acquire your new users. Those users, they're not online. So there, you either have to find a way to access them or you wouldn't succeed. And the way we thought about this problem is that we would create human referral networks. So what it means is that it's not just, you know, a problem of finding a user. It's also a problem of educating a user. So even if you have a simple use case saying, well, if you do start using this, right, if you start using this, this is how will you benefit. It's not always clear and obvious, right, for every mm-hmm. customer, every user that you might have. So there's a bit of educational lag in here. So that is why we found the very first set of ambassadors. So the people that are very proactive in their local communities, the people that already are aware of cryptocurrencies or aware of mobile tech that is out there that is available. So what we gave them is that we gave them an opportunity, right, to pretty much describe all of that to their local communities and see if that helps. So we make sure that they have an opportunity to actually be proactive in their community. And that's how the program started to work. So we do have currently more than 40 ambassadors. We actually have ambassadors in 13 countries. So even the countries where we don't operate, because we're already aligned and planning, you know, to go further and further. So the reason why we're open, fully open, only in 10 countries, because, even though we're a cryptocurrency company, we tend to work legally. So that is why we're communicating with the local governments, with regulatory groups there, just to make sure that we're pretty much like, you know, abiding with all the laws that are there. So that is why the ambassadors program is there for two reasons. So number one is for us to always have that immediate feedback about the users, right, that we're trying to help and we're trying to work with. And then number two, for us, it's a way to find and to access all of those closed communities that are pretty much closed for the rest of the world, but they're just successful and happy living their own there.
That's just so wonderful that you're bringing all these people together for a common good. Tell me a little bit about your background and how you got started with Humaniq.
Sure. So originally I'm from the Ukraine. So that's where I was born. So pretty much again, and I've seen two sides of the world, because I was raised in Ukraine. But then at the age of 15, I started studying at the University of Toronto at Toronto, Canada. And that's where I got graduated. Then I was working at the BMO. So that's the Bank of Montreal. So my background was involved with finance, with fintech. I also founded my own startup, FinLit. It was based on predefinable algorithmic scoring. And then I exited. And back in 2017, I got to know Alex Fork, which is our CEO. And then pretty much ever since I learned about the problem that he was working, I got in love, because seeing this pretty much like, you know, the world from two sides. So back in Ukraine, and then in Canada, I've seen it, you know, in all aspects. So I decided that I would really want to join the team. And the background and the technology that I do bring and the expertise that I do bring would benefit the project. So that's how we started together. So we've been together for more than a year now. It's been a crazy year. So many things happen. And then what more excites me is that how far we went from where we've been a year ago. Right. So that's when our ICO was conducted. And that's when we finished and successfully raised more than $5.2 million to the colon at that time. And where we see now and then where we stand now, that's, completely two different things, completely two different places.
What a wonderful journey. And with such a great positive impact coming with you in this wave. I can really hear the passion in your voice. And it's wonderful.
Thank you very much, Juliet. It's it's a pleasure talking here with you today. It's a pleasure explaining what do we do, and then pretty much the main reason is why do we do it. Again, as I've mentioned, right, ever since I've learned about an opportunity to actually work and then stay connected with fintech and also staying connected with the technology, with cutting edge tech, but also at the same time applying all of that knowledge, all of that expertise for the good. So since I come from the Ukraine, and that's where I've been raised, and I've seen the world from two different angles, I've also had my entire life connected and attached to fintech. And for me, it's an ultimate opportunity where I can apply my expertise and my knowledge in finance and fintech, and then stay pretty much, you know, in touch, and then stay connected to the cutting edge technologies that that we are applying and that we're working and trying to push forward, like biometrics, blockchain, and applying all of that to pretty much social good. So applying all of that to actually help and benefit our planet, to help and benefit the people out there. For me, it's an ultimate opportunity, and that's a win-win.
Absolutely.
So for me, it's an ultimate opportunity to change the world.
So what is the best way for people to also help change the world? You know, joining your open source code, becoming an ambassador, getting involved through challenges. What's the best place for people to come and learn more?
I guess you already named three of them. It literally depends on what exactly drives you, what exactly motivates you. What is your expertise? What do you want to help and what do you want to change with, right? So as I've mentioned, we're not an NGO, so we're not there just to simply give out money, right? So we're here to actually create a business that is sustainable, right? That is profitable, yet it's actually focused on the social goodness, right? So if you're a developer, let's try to work together. Let's try to create a service that you've always dreamed of creating. Yep, you know, providing you an access to this unbanked people. If you're a company, let's see what kind of partnerships we can do. If you're a young startup, we've conducted our first Humaniq Global Challenge. We will for surely do further ones down the road. So again, if you're a new startup, you can join that program once it opens up again. If you're an individual, if you already somehow, and you're hearing this podcast and you live in Africa and you do understand that there's an opportunity, right? There's a possibility to change, then let's become, if you do want, you can always become a part of our ambassadors program. So there are many different ways. It literally depends on what exactly you're passionate about and then what exactly you would really love to do.
Fantastic. Anton, thank you so much for joining us here today on Future Tech Podcast. It's been such a pleasure to speak with you.
Thank you very much, Juliet. It was a pleasure being here today.
That is Anton Mozgovoy. He is the CTO at Humaniq, and you can check out more information about them at humaniq.com. This has been Juliet Lamar with Future Tech Podcast. Thank you all so much for tuning in.
You have been listening to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Subscribe to this podcast both to review and discover more future technologies that are poised to transform our lives for better or worse, such as Bitcoin, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.